Today we're going to look at Stirling numbers of the first kind, beginning with the unsigned Stirling numbers. The unsigned Stirling number of the first kind, C sub nk, counts the number of permutations of n elements with k cycles. For example, if we had a list of 3 elements, and we wanted to find all the permutations with 2 cycles, which would require us to use 1 cycle of length 2 and 1 cycle of length 1, we have the following possibilities. There are other ways we could write these cycles, including swapping the order of the cycles, and rotating cycles, which is where we move the element in the last position of the cycle to the first position in the cycle. These do not change the permutation. Since there are 3 distinct permutations of a list of 3 elements with 2 cycles, C sub 3, 2 equals 3. Here are all the permutations of a list of 3 elements, along with their cycle notations and number of cycles. Unsigned Stirling number C sub 3, 1 equals 2 because there are 2 distinct permutations of 3 elements with 1 cycle. Stirling number C sub 3, 2 equals 3 because there are 3 distinct permutations of 3 elements with 2 cycles. And C sub 3, 3 equals 1 because there's 1 distinct permutation of 3 elements with 3 cycles. Before we look at the recursive relation for Stirling numbers of the first kind, let's look at a few basic properties, some of which you might already be able to guess from looking at our table here. First of all, we define C sub 0, 0 to be 1. Second, we can observe that C sub n 0 equals 0 for all n greater than 0, because there are no permutations of a non-empty list with 0 cycles. Also, C sub 0 k equals 0 for all k greater than 0, as there's no way to permute an empty list with a non-zero number of cycles. Similarly, C sub n k equals 0 for all k greater than n, as it's impossible to use more disjoint cycles than we have elements. If we start writing a table of our Stirling numbers of the first kind, these properties already let us fill in many of the entries in our table. With n along the rows and k along the columns, the first property tells us that the 0, 0 entry is 1. The last property tells us that all entries above the main diagonal are 0. The second property tells us that the rest of the entries in column 0 equal 0. Next, let's add another basic property. C sub n, n equals 1, because it corresponds to using all cycles of length 1. That's the permutation that does not rearrange our list at all, as all elements are mapped to themselves. This tells us that the main diagonal entries are all equal to 1 in our table. Let's look at just 3 more cool properties. C sub n1 equals n minus 1 factorial. Why? Well, we're asking for the number of distinct permutations whose cycle notation contains just 1 big cycle of all n elements. Also, there are n factorial ways that we can write the elements within this cycle. But while order does matter, not every way of ordering the elements in our cycle produces a distinct permutation, due to the fact that any number of rotations of any cycles produce the same permutation. For a single cycle of length n, we have n different ways to write the same permutation by rotating elements. Remembering that there are n factorial ways to write our elements within this big cycle, we have to divide by n to find the number of distinct permutations, which gives us n minus 1 factorial. We can now fill out the second column of our table with the factorials. As our next property, C sub n, n minus 1, equals n choose 2. This is because, for a permutation of n elements with n minus 1 cycles, we must use n minus 2 cycles of length 1 and 1 cycle of length 2. Because all our cycles are of length 1 or 2, the order of the elements within them doesn't matter at all. So this becomes a problem of asking how many ways we can choose 2 elements to form our 2 cycle, which is just n choose 2. Returning to our table, we can now fill in the next diagonal on our table. The last property we're going to look at, before looking at the recursive relation for Stirling numbers, is the summation over k of c sub n k. Fixing n and summing over k from 0 to n, we will be counting the distinct permutations of n elements with one cycle, adding it to the number of distinct permutations of n elements with two cycles, and so on. Since all permutations of n elements have somewhere between 1 and n cycles, the sum from k equals 0 to n will give us the total number of permutations of n elements, which is n factorial. You can see this to be true in the row sums of our table. Moving on, here is the recurrence relation for the unsigned Stirling numbers of the first kind. The combinatorial reason this is true comes down to cycle notation. Each distinct permutation of n elements with k cycles can be formed from a permutation of n minus 1 elements with k cycles by adding our nth element into one of the existing k cycles, or it can be formed from a permutation of n minus 1 elements with k minus 1 cycles by adding our nth element into its own cycle of length 1. Each distinct permutation of n minus 1 elements with k cycles gives us n minus 1 distinct permutations of n elements with k cycles, because there are n minus 1 positions that we can insert our nth element into such that we create a distinct permutation of n elements. Remember that placing the new element at the end or beginning of a cycle would produce the same result as each other, and placing it in an intermediate position in a cycle would produce a different permutation from placing it at any other intermediate position in that cycle. Counting the number of n positions and intermediate positions across all cycles is what gives us our total of n minus 1 places to insert such that we produce a new permutation. What we've shown so far is that for a given permutation of n minus 1 elements with k cycles, we can produce n minus 1 permutations of n elements with k cycles. However, we have c sub n minus 1 k of these permutations of n minus 1 elements with k cycles. So the number of permutations of n elements with k cycles formed via our first method is n minus 1 times c sub n minus 1 k. Moving on, each distinct permutation of n minus 1 elements with k minus 1 cycles gives us a distinct permutation of n elements with k cycles, found by placing the additional element into a cycle of length 1, all by itself. In total, there are c sub n minus 1, k minus 1 permutations of n elements with k cycles formed this way. Altogether, we have that the number of permutations of n elements with k cycles is the number of permutations of n minus 1 elements with k minus 1 cycles plus n minus 1 times the number of permutations of n minus 1 elements with k cycles. As an example of this relation, we can calculate c sub 4 of 2 using the values we have already found for c sub 3 2 and c sub 3 1. C sub 4 2 equals 11. Using this recursive relation and the initial conditions for Stirling numbers, we can generate any Stirling number we want, although we would need a computer program if we wanted to generate a large table of these numbers or a Stirling number with large n and k. Now, keeping this relation in mind, let's look at an equivalent algebraic definition of the unsigned Stirling numbers of the first kind. The unsigned Stirling number of the first kind, c sub nk, can be defined as the coefficient on the k degree term and the nth rising factorial, which is defined as the product of linear factors x, x plus 1, x plus 2, and so on up to x plus n minus 1. For example, the rising factorial with n equal to 3 is x times x plus 1 times x plus 2, which is expanded to x cubed plus 3x squared plus 2x. If you notice, the coefficient on the kth degree term is indeed c sub 3k, which you can verify by checking our table. Here are some of the other rising factorials for small n. We can see that the rising factorial coefficients agree with the Stirling numbers up to n equals 3. And it turns out that we can show that the recurrence relation for Stirling numbers of the first kind is the same as the recurrence relation for coefficients on terms in the rising factorial, meaning that the Stirling numbers defined algebraically agree with those defined combinatorially earlier in the video. Let a sub nk be the coefficient on the kth degree term of the nth rising factorial. Remember that we can obtain the nth rising factorial from the n minus 1th rising factorial by multiplying by x plus n minus 1. Distributing, prior to combining like terms, we're going to have two terms with degree k in the nth rising factorial. One found by multiplying the x in our new factor by the k minus 1 degree term in the n minus 1th rising factorial, and one found by multiplying the n minus 1 in our new factor by the k degree term in the n minus 1th rising factorial, meaning the coefficient of the kth degree term in the nth rising factorial, that is a sub nk, will be a sub n minus 1 k minus 1 plus n minus 1 times a sub n minus 1 k. This is the same recurrence relation as that for Stirling numbers of the first kind, defined through counting permutations according to their number of cycles. We know that the coefficients of their rising factorial share initial conditions with the combinatorially defined Stirling numbers, so the algebraic definition of Stirling numbers of the first kind agrees with the combinatorial definition of Stirling numbers of the first kind for all n and k. This gives us two ways to think about these numbers. So far, we've been discussing unsigned Stirling numbers. But we also have the signed Stirling numbers of the first kind, which only have an algebraic definition. They are defined to be the coefficients of the expansion of the falling factorial, which is the product of linear factors shown here. Again, here are a few of the expanded falling factorials for small n. The signed Stirling numbers have the same absolute values as the unsigned Stirling numbers, so their absolute values can still be used to count permutations of n elements according to number of cycles. We can prove a recurrence relation for these numbers using the same approach as before with the rising factorial and the unsigned Stirling numbers. Let a sub nk be the coefficient on the kth degree term of the nth falling factorial. We can obtain the nth falling factorial from the n minus 1th falling factorial by multiplying by x minus n minus 1. Again, we distribute, and prior to simplification, we see that there are two terms with degree k. One found by multiplying the x in our linear factor by the k minus 1 degree term of the n minus 1th falling factorial, and one found by multiplying the negative n minus 1 in our linear factor by the k degree term of the n minus 1th falling factorial. This reveals that a sub nk equals a sub n minus 1 k minus 1 minus n minus 1 times a sub n minus 1 k. Our initial values combined with this recurrence relation would allow us to find any signed Stirling number. To finish the video, I'd like to leave you with an exercise. Show that when n plus k is odd, the sign of the signed Stirling number is negative. To summarize what we've covered in this video, the unsigned Stirling numbers count permutations according to the number of cycles, and equivalently, they're the coefficients in the expansion of the rising factorial. The signed Stirling numbers have absolute value equal to the unsigned Stirling numbers, and they are the coefficients in the expansion of the falling factorial. We have a recurrence relation for both the unsigned and signed Stirling numbers, and they're pretty similar, with the only difference being the sign of the last term. That's it for this video. Thanks for watching. If you enjoyed this video, please subscribe. Have a great day.